So you'll be presenting surface tents, convective thresholds, and the nonlinear climate response to tropical SSTs.
Thanks. Yes, you read that right. It says surface tents. Yeah, so my name is Andrew Williams, PhD student at Oxford, and this is some work I've been doing in collaboration with Nadir and Jonah, who's somewhere here. So just to get started, oh wait, can I just click it?
Yeah,
or do
nice.
I, okay.
Yeah.
But can you see the mouse? Okay, cool. So a lot of this work is motivated by the SST pattern effect. So just in case you haven't heard enough about that already today, very briefly, it's just this idea that radiative fluxes at the top of atmosphere depend on the spatial pattern of SST anomalies. So in the case of the tropics, we can think about this with this very simple conceptual picture. So what I'm showing here is kind of climatological SSTs in the Pacific Basin. You have warm SSTs, cold SSTs. Over the warmest SSTs, you get deep convection, which puts you on a moist adiabatic temperature profile. You then have weak temperature gradients in the tropical free troposphere, which imprint that temperature profile across the whole tropics, even over these regions where you have cold boundary layers because you have cold SSTs. And what that does is it sets up this kind of inversion structure here, and low clouds love an inversion. So they love an inversion because it helps trap moisture in the boundary layer, and you get preferential formation of these low clouds, which reflect loads of incoming solar radiation. So let's take this picture and let's warm in a region of tropical subsidence. So watch the inversion weakens. So in this picture where you warm in a region of tropical subsidence, you don't affect the free tropospheric temperature profile, you just warm the boundary layer. That weakens the inversion, causes fewer low clouds, less shortwave reflectance, and that's a positive impact on Earth's TOA. But instead, if you warm in the Western Pacific, what you do is you basically put the whole atmosphere onto a warmer, moist adiabat locally. That temperature profile, again, gets transmitted over to these regions of low clouds and subsidence, and you get a stronger inversion, more low clouds, and that's a negative TOA response. So basically, where you put the warming can set off these kind of circulation mechanisms, which give you vastly different TOA. And now, we want to be a little bit more quantitative with this, not just have pretty pictures. So one way that people have gone about kind of tackling that is through the use of what are called Green's functions. So the idea here is, you know, you can take these warming patches and run them in an atmosphere-only model. And rather than just running them in one location, you can run them in hundreds of locations. So this is a nice schematic from Yue's paper, where they took an atmosphere-only model, forced with climatological SSTs and sea ice, and then you do these kind of SST perturbations in loads of different regions, calculate the change in TOA for each of those experiments, and then you can construct a map like this, which is called a Green's function, which basically is a way of quantifying the expected change in global mean TOA for a change in SST at each location. So this is saying that when you warm in the Western Pacific, you expect a negative impact on the TOA flux because of what we just saw, this change in the inversion in low clouds, versus when you warm in the Eastern Pacific, it's a positive influence on the TOA, it's a warming impact. So this is great, if it works, you never have to run atmosphere-only models ever again, you know, we can just trust this. However, there's a problem here. The issue is that, you know, this kind of, you know, watts per meter squared per Kelvin, this is kind of coming from a linear regression. So when you do this type of work, you're assuming that your relationship between global mean TOA flux and local SST for a given region maybe looks something like this. So, you know, you get the origin for free, you run one experiment, you assume that, oh dear, oh, you assume it looks something like that, but it could look different, right? It could look very, very different, and a priori, it's not sure which, it's not clear which one of these are true, and obviously, if you try drawing a line through the origin to match these points, you could be very biased. So that's where we come in. What we did was we took the ICON model, run in atmosphere-only mode, and we chose four patches for these kind of SST perturbations. So spanning regions of intense convection on the Indonesian Ocean, the maritime continent, all the way over to a region which is characterized in our model by low clouds and subsidence here. And for each of them, we ran experiments with kind of plus or minus 1K, plus or minus 2K, et cetera. And what I've plotted here is the global mean TOA flux for each of these experiments versus the size of the warming. And you don't have to think about it too much to just see that it's not linear, right? So you can't use the 3K experiment here to recreate the minus 3K experiment. Now, in the interest of time, we'll just focus on what's happening in the Western Pacific. So in the Western Pacific, when you warm in this region, you get a negative TOA impact, which is kind of what we expect. You warm the upper atmosphere, you stabilize the whole tropics, negative TOA through changes in low clouds. and that seems to increase kind of quasi-linearly with your forcing strength. But and when you cool in the Western Pacific, you get a slightly positive TOA, so it's linear over a certain region, but then you very quickly saturate. And even if you're putting in kind of minus 4K perturbations here, you're not strongly affecting the TOA any extra. So we want to understand why that is. And in this work, we suggest that you can intuitively think about these nonlinearities if you picture the tropical atmosphere as a circus tent. So in case you don't know what that is, that's a kind of tent that looks something like this. And it's basically a tight fabric held up by poles in different locations, potentially of different heights. Now, if you interpret this circus tent with the fabric being the temperature of the free troposphere, the poles as being centers of deep convection, and the height of these poles as being the SST, or like the boundary layer temperature, or you can think of this all in MSC as well, but temperature gives you the right type of thing, you end up with a picture which looks a little bit more like this. So this is just showing a transect from kind of some warm SSTs, some cold SSTs, and what this is saying is that when you get deep convection, you've got a pole that's pushing up the temperature of the free troposphere in that region, because as we saw before, deep convection warms the whole, you know, impacts the temperature of the whole column. And then again, through weak temperature gradient arguments, this temperature doesn't just fall off straight away, but it kind of gets imprinted across the whole tropics, and you set up these inversions. So in this model, you've got the height of this pole, which is kind of telling you the temperature of the boundary layer here, relatively cold, and the difference between the height of the circus tent and the pole is giving you your inversion strength. So hopefully that's made it clear. So we can use this model now, and we can think about, okay, what happens if we warm in a convective region? So if you warm in a convective region, what you're doing is you're taking a tent pole, which is already in contact with this fabric, you know, the temperature of the free troposphere, and you're just pushing it up, because the height of the pole is correlated with like how warm the boundary layer is. So you push up the height of this tent fabric, that it gets imprinted across the whole of the tropics, you get stronger inversions, more low clouds, negative TOA. And there's no obvious upper limit to this. You can just keep punching up into that tent fabric. Now, if you cool in a convective region, initially you're lowering the height of this tent fabric. So, you know, and then because you've got something which is already in contact, pushing up, and then through tension you lower it, you kind of lower this fabric across the whole of the tropics, you get a weaker inversion. But if you continue to cool in a convective region, eventually you just shut down deep convection. And in that model, it's the equivalent of having your tent pole now no longer in contact with the fabric of the free troposphere. And now the tent pole can go down as far as it likes. The free troposphere doesn't really care. And that's kind of should sound familiar, because that's kind of what we see in this setup as well. Some conclusions. Green's functions are one method that people have used to try and quantify the pattern effect, but that particular method assumes linearity. We kind of looked at it, and non-linearity is a fairly ubiquitous and fundamental feature of the tropics, we argue. And you can understand it intuitively by thinking of the tropical atmosphere as a circus tent. So we have just Google the title of this talk and you'll get a preprint with more details. Merry Christmas.
Thanks very much. So we have an issue with the Zoom that appears to have crashed.
You did look quite nervous.
Yeah, okay. So we lost our 50 attendees online or something.